Inches away from our feet, but worlds apart, lies vast, unmapped territory.
It's only that far away from us, but it's underground, and it's a completely another universe. It's a three-dimensional, complex habitat. The most complex, diverse habitat on the planet Earth is soil. A single pinch of soil contains over a billion microorganisms.
But it's not the tiny organisms that grab the attention of Oregon State University soil scientist James Cassidy. It's the creatures that left fields full of these holes.
This is a vole. For all intents and purposes, a vole is just a little mouse.
The gray-tailed vole is the most common vole in the Willamette Valley. It has adapted well to life underground.
What do they do down there? That's a harder question to answer because it's underground.
Cassidy reasoned that if the voles leave holes in the soil, that must affect how water and possibly agricultural chemicals drain from fields. To test his idea, he poured dye and plaster into the tunnels. After the plaster hardened, his team began a dig like archaeologists.
So water's funneling into the system, and then this is a void here that can store quite a bit of water, probably more than you might actually imagine. In some of these tunnels, we were able to pour 15 to 20, maybe 30 gallons of liquid plaster down before they appeared to fill up.
It was as if the soil had developed a second surface a few inches underground. The vole tunnels had created whole new reservoirs to hold moisture. But his experiments created a dilemma. By cutting them apart, his methods ruined the very tunnels he wanted to study.
And to study a system like this and not destroy it at the same time is a difficult prospect.
He found a solution when he learned he could peer into the vole's world.
Oh, here we go.
With a long, snake-like camera.
Oh man, that is so cool. It's very cozy down there. You know, it's always cool. It's always a little moist down there.
Perfectly comfortable for a vole and others.
Oh, wow, whoa, whoa. Got a fly. There's a fly crawling around.
Cassidy's probe camera finds fresh evidence of voles.
Yep. There's some poops. This is an active tunnel.
To his wonder, he once surprised the tunnel's owner. The camera came nose to nose with an unperturbed vole.
But then to run into them and to find that they were relatively undisturbed by our presence. I mean, we didn't ever anticipate we'd be that lucky.
For the first time, Cassidy gets to see the soil he studies without digging it up.
Oh my God, that's beautiful. Even though it's just a hole in the ground, a small vole tunnel, when you get down to that size with that camera, it is like exploring a cavern. It's like spelunking.
The probe camera also makes a discovery. Grass lying loose in the tunnels.
There's actually accumulated fresh green grass down in there, and that's going in there and decomposing. And inside, that's deep down in the soil.
Now he knows where the grass goes, back into their burrows. It's this revelation that leads him to utter a comparison bound to make him very unpopular.
And so in a way, the voles are sort of like doing some of the same functions as earthworms. And farmers all love earthworms. So it's not a big stretch to think of them in the same way.
Yeah, but I'd rather have worms.
Grass seed farmer Tim Creeder says earthworms are friends. Voles, he says, are no earthworms.
Oh, they're like a miniature rat. They are voracious eaters. They'll consume anything in their path. This seed will get another foot and a half taller. It's a smorgasbord for them right now.
Creeder and virtually every grass seed farmer in the Willamette Valley dealt with a massive explosion of vole numbers in 2005.
The voles were terrible. They were horrific. I'd never seen anything like it in my 30 years of farming.
Creeder says he lost 30 to 40% of the seed in some fields. His losses were small. Some farms lost 70% of their crops. Voles numbered in the thousands per acre, with probably millions of them in the Willamette Valley.
It's the worst infestation of animals that I've seen in a crop.
So we'll check to see if we've got something. And we do. This trap actually has a little vole in it.
OSU biologist Jennifer Gervais confirms the Oregon vole surge in 2005 was the largest in 50 years.
And I'm holding her like that so she can't bite me. And so that's what her belly looks like. They're all white underneath.
Vole numbers often go boom and bust, she says. But the Willamette Valley outbreak exceeded that. She calls it an eruption.
Oh, rabbits have nothing on voles. No, they don't. They don't. They have an incredible reproductive output. These guys can breed when they're 3 weeks old. They can have a litter every 3 weeks. They can have anywhere between 4 and 7 young per litter when life is good.
The cause of the population boom, be it easy food, great weather, or perfect moisture, remains unknown.
And we still aren't all that close to an answer.
Farmers knew they had to do something against one of the worst natural destructive forces unleashed on their fields in half a century. But poison baits can kill birds. Despite restrictions, they got out of hand in one part of the valley that year. Hundreds of Canada geese were killed.
But yes, we use poison.
Tim Creeder could only use bait for a few months, and it had to be placed directly in the vole holes.
And so you do it one hole at a time, yes. Very labor intensive.
So a number of farmers are trying another approach. It's natural and lasts all year. Bruce and Helen Rudenclaw are putting in their first.
Get a little dirt in there so we can hold it tight at the bottom.
It's a raptor perch.
Looks good. It's pretty level that direction.
They hope the poles will attract the vole's prime enemies, hawks, owls, and other birds of prey.
These guys will work for free, so if I put up a house for them, maybe we'll get them to come and help us out some.
We're trying to find any type of solution that will work.
Tim Creeder put in 63 perches, one for every 10 acres of his farm.
When we first put up the perches, I had sparrowhawks and redtails using them the next day.
The perches came free from the Yamhill County Soil and Water District. It's handing out 400 of them countywide.
With the raptor poles that we put up, we're trying to take the peak out of the rise and fall. So if we do get a problem, it won't be as bad.
Vole numbers have dropped, probably from natural cycles. And as for their possible benefits, farmers like Creeder concede the point with conditions.
I would have to probably agree with that the voles do provide some benefit when they are in a number that is reasonable.
We're just beginning to understand how they fit into the ecological system.
At OSU, James Cassidy believes the voles, even in normal years, could be more important to the health of the valley soils than anyone has realized.
I think they're kind of a key player. They're sort of the lions and the Serengeti, maybe, in this environment. Somewhere in between is the mighty vole. Earthworm, lion, you decide.